name is Katrina, I'm 29 years old. I'm from Sweden, in the middle part of Sweden. In my childhood, I didn't have any special belief. My parents didn't have a Christian faith, but my grandmother had. She had a very strong Christian faith. And also my aunts and cousins had a Christian faith. So in somehow you were inspired of this, how to be as a person or how to think and act in certain situations. When I grow older, maybe, I don't know, when you're starting to be a teenager, when you're searching who am I, what I want to do in this life and all of this, I didn't believe in God, but I believed in something higher than us. That is something with a perfect intelligence that, for example, natural laws inside of the universe, that if you give something out, you will get something back. And the law of attraction, and you attract the same thing. And whatever you do is the good and the bad. It comes from you. You yourself choose what you want to happen with yourself. But I was also like in the childhood, always searching for something because it was something missing in the Swedish culture or in the Swedish way of life or how you put your focus on the goals and all of this. I remember my neighbors was Muslims when I was 7 years of age, and I was not so comfortable maybe with the children on my own age or the girls in the class. So the Muslims got to be my best friends, actually, because they were so easy to hang around with, and they opened their whole home, and it was so, you felt like loved and seen as a person, and you didn't need to be a certain kind, or you were only loved for who you were, in one way. But then you turn, somehow when you still have Swedish parents, right, you know you're not a Muslim, because you're not a Muslim, you're a Swedish person, right? The nationality tells everything about us. But the whole search, I always was attracting people that had Muslim belief, but they left the religion. Maybe one of the parents was Muslim and one of them was Swedish, and they didn't focus on the religion belief in the family. So, but still the akhlaq of the persons was coming from Islam somehow. I realized after I converted to Islam that it always attracted me, this the akhlaq of Islam and how to be the role models of all the prophets. And I was working together with one Muslim that came back to Islam, actually, that left it a little bit in his teenage years, and then he came back. And in this work, it was not so many people that I got along with. So it was most interesting to understand his belief, and I knew him as a friend before. So it was interesting to see him change from not having the belief so strong until starting to get the belief. And this change made a very huge impact on me because he got so strong and always was smiling and was so happy and thankful, and he started to pray, and it filled him with this positive energy and way of life. And these small things, you know, you always make wudu before you pray, or like the cleanness in the religion. You have to be very clean and take care of yourself and always be very humble to you and to others. And it's very interesting. And then I got interested, but somehow in the beginning I was asking so much, like, okay, but the women are oppressed, and the women has to always go back the man, and this and that, and all these misconceptions you have in your mind because of maybe you were watching some movies before that had a very bad connection with Islam. And always I didn't listen to him. I was thinking like, yeah, this is what you say just to get me hooked to come to the religion and to start to be a Muslim, right? So one day he got really angry, like really angry, and like, if you're going to ask me questions and you don't want to listen to my answers, why do you ask? Why? If you don't want to listen, don't ask. And then I started to think like, why? How can this be? I always was a open person. I traveled a lot, was working in another country, was trying to find what really life was about, right? So when he asked me to stop to ask him questions because I didn't listen to him, it really got me to think, why don't I listen to him? How come? I never saw myself like a close-minded person or someone that didn't listen to what people were thinking or couldn't discuss other ideas. And it made a very, I don't know, it was like the whole base of your world fall down. Because you realized, wow, what if what he says is true? Maybe they really are respecting women and they are loving each other the best they can do, and they want to give away everything they have they could give to their brother, because it would be better for them to have it than to have themselves. And what if there really is a paradise and we really have hell, and what is really God then? And all of these questions started to pop in my mind, and I also saw this documentary, The Arrivals. And it also made you, because I always was knowing in the society it was something wrong, and something was like, we don't get told the whole picture, right? So somehow, yeah, you started to think. And I went traveling after this work, actually. And when I came there, I was like, I wanted to only talk about God. I wanted not to do anything else. As soon as I find a Christian person, I was like, what do you believe in? What is heaven for you? But what about this? What about that? What about this? And they always wanted to discuss it. And then one day on the trip, I realized that if God is the concept of this concept I have, of something higher than ourselves that we cannot describe, and that and that always somehow wants us good, because it's always something in the whole life telling you, you can do better, something better will come, something, right? So then I started to understand that the concept I had, maybe it is God. And that makes a big, huge impact on the life, right? Because then you started to search in about God and really thinking, maybe this is it. And the more you read and the more you search, it makes sense. Because the whole life you were, I not always had the strongest connection with my family, right? So you don't have this protection of someone like always looking after you or taking care of you. And then somehow you are very connected to God in one way, right? Because it's the only thing you can be connected to if you don't have your parents. And this, and everything you read in Quran or in Hadith or about the way of life in Islam, it's the same connection you've been talking to the whole life. So you know it's the truth when you face it. It's like the light is so strong, and it's strong. And when I came back from the trip, I was so interested in Islam, and I wanted to go on the Friday prayer so much. I wanted to go there and to meet all the people and to pray this. I was very excited about this. I remember I started to pray again pretty fast when I came home. I asked one friend that was praying, a brother actually, because I didn't know any sisters then. I knew some brothers. So I sent them an email and like, can you show me how to pray? And then I started to pray and I started to read, and I wanted to read all the time, and I wanted to talk about it all the time, and I wanted to know more and more and more, and looking at, I don't know, lectures and all of this. Started to go to Quran school. Went inside, put hijab, went out, took it off, I don't know, doing it every Saturday and Sunday. Went to this conference, was sitting there like thinking, wow, you find the meaning of life. This is like the whole essence of the life, and how to take care of your soul and how to take care of others and how to combine everything together in the perfect sense, right? It's not easy. This is not easy. And it takes more than just a couple of years to be a Muslim and to know how to really become a Muslim. It's different to be a Muslim and to be a believer and to be strong in your faith. It takes time, patience, right? Lots of patience. But I was on this conference, a Sunni conference, and I had my sisters from the school. They were much younger, like 14, 16, something like this. So they come one day and ask me, but when are you going to convert? And these days before, I was always thinking so much like, you should convert. Are you really believing God? Are you God-fearing? Or is it something you say? Or what is this? When are you going to take the step? Are you going to believe in it? God always put you in the best. The whole life he took care of you. And you always were thinking you will end somewhere, but you ended up much better. And this time you're going to doubt that this, when you are so sure in your heart and your mind and the soul, it knows it's the same. How can you doubt it? And this day, this girl comes to me, one of the days when I've been thinking so much about it, and she's like, when will you convert? So you feel like God is helping you in the right matter of way, right? Using her to come there. So I came to this, so after she asked me, when will you convert? This woman lecturer that had the lecture in the conference, she came and asked me if I wanted to convert, because she heard from the other sisters, of course, I wanted to convert. So I said, I'm not sure. And she said, why? And I remember I had some questions I didn't know how to deal with. So I decided to do it there because I needed to prove that I was God-fearing, that I really believed in God. Did I believe in it, or was it something I said, or why I wanted to go in this way of life? And you should always put the trust in Allah, totally. The more you put the trust there, the more trust you will get back. Or you get the same amount, because it's how it works. It made me feel relieved. The conversion made me feel very relieved. Filled with hope and something you longed so long for. Because all my life I was looking for role models, right? Since I didn't have the perfect connection with my parents somehow. Or I didn't believe in all the ways they were living or how they were acting or not acting. So when you totally find these perfect role models, how you should adapt your life and you're living, you're eating, you're sleeping, you're... Yeah, more or less everything. How you should act and dress, and how you should to be a person, to be modest, to be the most you can be, and to respect others. Since Islam is mostly about respecting as much as you can to your sisters and to your brothers and to everybody's rights, and very perfect. So it gave you this very big feeling of relief. I came to Shia most because of the unknowledge on the Sunni side. They always was claiming Shia to be something, and in the end, when you ask them about it, it was not true. And when you were starting to read about it, you also realized it's not true. And also, Shia always said to me, go and study their schools, go and be with them, go on their courses, study their fiqh, do everything, read their books, especially read their books, read about the history, learn about what really happened. But Sunni was always like, don't go to them, it will get you to hell, and no, don't be with them. So somehow the merciness was missing in there, right? Because the same light you see when you find Islam, the same darkness was there somehow when they talk about Shia, because you should be, who can be closer to you and a Muslim that prays and to fast? Either you have the same political belief or still you have so much together. Why not focus on the part together than to focus on everything that separates you? It's not working. So somehow when they never had the knowledge that was right and you came back to Shia to ask them about it, how can you follow someone that doesn't know what they're talking about? Then you get interested after a while. And you're starting to read and you're starting to hear about different episodes and what happened on the Thursday, Black Thursday, and what happened with the Camel War, and you're starting to read and you get interested in the history, and then you really see in their hadiths that the Ahlul Bayt has a high status in their books. So how can you deny it? It's not possible. And I don't know. And you have to have perfect role models. If God is going to send you some role models, they have to be perfect. Otherwise, how can we follow them? Otherwise, we will also go around to believe we will always make mistakes. We will not come to perfection. How will we come to perfection if not the ones we're following is not perfect? It doesn't make sense. So I saw the same light in Ahlul Bayt and the love for them and their teaching, and the hadiths was always very strong. And so somehow when I saw the light, I was sure. I was sure before, so why shouldn't I be sure again? Why doubt it? I started to look after lectures. It's very tough, actually. Sunnis are very having a lot of things everywhere. Shias, you have to search and you have to be patient. But we all know the best thing comes to the patient. So you be patient and you go to one thing and it leads you to another event and it leads you to one mosque and it leads you to another organization. And somehow, I don't know, when I just knew the light, I just stayed there. And I didn't question it. And also the things, how people that don't believe, for example, my family, some of them, they don't listen to me, right? Exactly the way I didn't listen to Muslims from the beginning. They don't listen to me either. But the same thing Sunni doesn't do with Shias. They don't listen to us either. It's the same. So it's like you come one step and you have the non-believers don't believe in you. You go another step and you have them not believing you. In my life before to now, yeah, it's a big difference. It's